everyone present in this August meeting. So I will request Professor Arpana Rawal Madam to please begin the proceedings.
Good afternoon, everyone, respected dignitaries, organizers of AICTE, CSBTU jointly organized FDP program on ML with Python. We are on to the next day of this particular workshop. So we have with us eminent personality as our guest of the session, Colonel B. Venkat sir, who is Director AICTE. I'm highly obliged to introduce him. Colonel B. Venkat is a serving Army officer from Technical Branch, Corps of Electronics and Mechanical Engineering. Having done his Mechanical Engineering degree from Army Institute, he is having nearly 30 years of service experience and has served in all possible appointments of command staff and instructions across the nation and abroad. The honorable officer is presently serving as director to AICTE and is handling faculty development relevant issues, obviously the release of grants through AICTE QIS schemes. Sir, you have a unique distinction of representing the nation as its technical military attached to Russia too. You have also been handling AICTE quality initiatives like National Initiative for Technical Teachers Training, which is mandatory for purposes of regularization and promotion to all teachers, implementation of examination reforms, AICTE, students' learning assignments, 360 degree feedback for them, and processes for implementation under National Education Policy 2020. So I on behalf of the whole BIT fraternity, wholeheartedly welcome you, sir, for this session. I request you to please take over the stage and proceed.
Thank you, ma'am, and warm regards, Aparna ma'am. That was very well introduced. And thank you, the Honorable VC also in attendance, various dignitaries. Kare sir, with your permission, I'll commence straight with that topic which has been given. Topic
yes,
is
sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome.
Thank you, sir. Topic is
sir.
NEP Open Education
sir,
Policy.
PMC, sir, PMC Project Monitoring Committee Chairman is also present.
Dr. Matharu, sir.
Yes, sir. He is from NIT Raipur and Vice Chancellor has appointed him as chairman of PMC.
Matharu, sir, very warm regards. Very warm regards to you also, sir. Thank you, sir. And with that, I'll come straight to the topic per se. Topic happens to be NEP 2020. It is already there on the website. Each one of you must have gone through that. At least I can be very well rest assured. And you would have understood that the initial 8 chapters pertain to the school education, and subsequently from 9 onwards till 24, it's the higher education, with the last 3 chapters, 25, 26, 27, being the implementable strategy, which is mentioned in the NEP 2020. Ladies and gentlemen, what we would be going is basically the NEP and the implementable action plans, because it's a policy, and a policy is as good or bad as it is implemented, at least at the roadmap of implementation. Very pertinent to understand as to NEP 2020 directly, how is it affecting us? When we talk of us, it is the higher education, and more so pertinent to the higher technical education in the higher education sector also. I would be taking my talk in such a manner, sir, pardon my this thing, there is no structured talk. I do not carry any presentation to this, neither I move in a sequence. I would be taking you on a path of a student's journey right from his school time till the graduation, and from there, at every point, I'll keep connecting to the higher technical education. That way, connectivity and understanding of the subject will be much, much easier. And if I may start straight away, the school education implementation is being termed now by the ministry as Sarthak, and implementation of the higher education portion of the NEP is being called as Samarth. So these are the terminologies which has happened, and very clearly one should be understanding MHRD has renamed itself as MOE. So that was the first significant development which happened towards moving on an implementable plan. The naming change of the ministry does signify the seriousness primarily due to the timelines which have been set in, and there is the go-ahead signal given as and the ball started rolling. If I may talk now, school education against the present system of 10 plus 2, the school education has gone to 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. There is a significance, there is an understanding, and there is a logic as to why it went into this four dimensions of the school education from the existing 10 plus 2. The first five, which is called as the foundational stage, which is nothing but 3 years of pre-primary and two class one, class two, is the foundational stage of any school student from now on as per the implemental portion of NCTE and NCERT, which is now going on. What has happened and the importance of this is the education in this particular foundational stage perforce will be given in regional languages. That is the importance, and that is the point which is coming out from here, which earlier was never there as a matter of a permanence mandatory activity to be carried out. It has also been proven, and it has been psychometrically, and it's also been proven over a period of time that this is the right age group for a children who, with his parents in this parental time, can understand and pick up the language and the vocabulary, and then why can't he be exposed to his regional language? If this is the activity which has been given here, a straight connect, I will take it to the higher technical education. From here, this particular subject of promotion in regional languages, the NEP also says when it comes to the higher education that the opportunity to the students be also given to pursue higher education in regional languages. If that is the point which has come out as a point of policy, implementable point is it needs to be done with immediate effect. And at AICT, on behest of the ministry, we have already commenced our activities towards higher technical education being provided in regional languages to the extent that 147 MOOCs online courses have been identified on SWAYAM platform, out of which 48 in phase one are already under translation into the 8 regional languages. The 8 regional languages which has already been identified for translation purposes are Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Kannada, Bengali, Gujarat, Marathi, and Hindi. This is being in phase one, and then it's likely to be extended upon in phase two to 3 more languages. That is one. Number two activity is the original technical book writing, and then its translation into the 8 plus 3, 11 different languages, an activity in which we have already incorporated our technical university all across, and CSVTU also has been one of our partners in this particular activity. I have also got the names of probable authors who are going to be translating once the book has been written in English into the regional Hindi. This activity is not only happening for the undergraduate first year, it is also happening for the diploma first year. And at the same time, AICT guidelines have also been modified with every institute and any institute who they can offer an additional supernumerary strength of 30 plus 60 additional students for the purpose of the providing them education in the regional languages, provided that that particular discipline has got an NBA accreditation and certain one or two more parameters. Suffice to say that when we called for applications, already 15 institutes have put up their applications to provide education in regional languages. So that's the pace at which from the current academic year, people are willing to continue or provide education to their students in the regional languages. And there is another direct connect of the promoting of education in regional languages, that is with the overall improvement in the gross enrollment ratio. This is also another very important aspect of the national education policy, which says that the current gross enrollment ratio of the Government of India, which is 26.4, this needs to be made to 50%. What is gross enrollment ratio? Gross enrollment ratio is nothing, number of students who are pursuing higher technical education, because we are talking about higher technical education. So the number of students who are pursuing higher technical education vis-a-vis the number of students of that age group who are available in that geographical area. That is what is called a GER. And as far as the country is concerned, it is 26.4 after practically 7 decades of our independence. And the expectation and the mission and the vision of the NEP is that by 2035, this need practically should be doubled to 50%, 50. If that has to be there, then there are a whole lot of activities which needs to be moved in unison or in together and a collective wholesome effort of institutes, organizers, the regulatory bodies, the center, the state, everybody has to walk the path together to ensure that we reach to a path of 50% in gross enrollment ratio. Moving ahead on the student's journey, now when the student moves ahead from the foundational stage, he goes to the next 3 years, which is class 3, 4, and 5. This is called as the preparatory stage. Now, at the preparatory stage, the important facets which have happened is that the student has an option to continue his teaching and learning in the regional language that he has chosen, or this is the first time that any other medium of instruction or medium of language is also will be exposed to him. It is absolutely the individual choice to pursue in the language chosen or to move forward with another language chosen. And at the same time, this is the first time the age bracket wherein the students, in addition to their general education which is going on, they would be little bit exposure, I'm again using the word, a little bit exposure would be given to skill or vocational subjects, which we call it. A very pertinent topic, skill and vocational, how is it connected to the higher technical education? For some unfortunate reasons, whatever the case may be, always a general education is seen as slightly a better option as compared to a vocational education. That is the general mindset. That is how it is. Why and for what reasons, that is not for us to dwell upon it. But the national education policy is very clear in its mandate that there will be no difference between general education and vocational education. If that difference has to be set aside, then in that case, how as for the implementable plans are to be made? Implementable plans are very clear that the learning outcomes of the vocational education to be aligned in such a manner that they are aligned to the learning outcomes of the general education, and if need be, certain amount of bridge courses to be built in. And at the same time, if you talk of the vis-a-vis, general education has to be aligned to the outcomes to the vocational education, then in that case, certain skill set courses or orientation of skill as part of certain credit-based courses to be incorporated into their curricula. These are two very important aspects, both on which, as of today, when we are speaking, the work is already going on. Mind you, gentlemen, I use the word credit-based courses. I'll keep coming back to this. I use the word gross enrollment ratio. I'll keep coming back to it, because these are one of the most important parameters of national education policy. The moment you align vocational education to general education, already this also becomes one of the contributory factors to our overall improvement in the gross enrollment ratio. Connect has to be with the gross enrollment ratio. So there again, we go on for improving the gross enrollment ratio. Towards this, the national education policy has directed for a setting up of a National Commission for Integration of Vocational Education, NCIVE. As we are speaking, this committee has already speaking been constituted. They are already on the work. The task and mandate of this committee is to give a guidelines and framework for NHEQF and NSQF, National Higher Education Qualification Framework, National Skill Qualification Framework, and align them in such a manner that they both work together. When you align an educational framework body and you align a skill framework body together, that is where you will be coming to a common meeting point, which is supposed to be desired as per NCIVE. And subsequently, when the graduates are passing out, the graduate will be passing out to be defined in terms of levels attained. That level subsequently to be aligned to not only to NOS, that is the National Occupation Standards, it to be aligned to the IOS, which is the International Occupation Standards, thereby giving our graduate that much more opportunity for the purposes of employment, not only in the country, but even internationally anywhere. So that is the overall outcome of vocational education as what is come out in the national education policy. And I already mentioned to you, the committee has been constituted, the work has already started off as far as the revising of the curriculum, certain bridge courses at AICT. No, Manoranjan Kumar, sir, I said in the beginning, I'm not sharing any presentation. It's always better to speak on the subject as we are moving, and your attention will be much more to the subject which is being spoken rather than on the screen. Apology, but that is how I generally give a talk. When the alignment is complete together, this is going to be a large contributory factor to the gross enrollment ratio. Now, very important point which has been found mentioned in the national education policy is inclusion and importance of the Lok Vidya. Now, what is the Lok Vidya? Lok Vidya, nothing but regional language which are peculiar to a very specific region, which has been in plenty, in abundance held with our local artisans, and that they keep giving it from generation to generations, unless and until you handle them with a lot of care, include them in your curriculum. These important educational values of wisdom are going to be lost over a period of time. So NEP has given a recommendation as a policy that this to be included as a vocational education subject. Now it's up to the bodies, future multidisciplinary institutes which are going to be coming in, to take this particular subject as a credit-based vocational education and offer to the student. Mind you, again, I'm repeating, I will come back to the word credit, a larger understanding and enhancement of this word credit. But suffice to say at this point of time that even a subject such as Lok Vidya has been recommended to be coming in into your curriculum for the purposes of graduation of a particular student. So moving ahead from here, that is from preparatory stage, we go to the next three. The next three is called the middle stage, that is class 6, 7, and 8. If 6, 7, and 8 happens to be the middle stage here, the most important aspect is the continuity option for a student to pursue his education in the language that he has chosen is permitted and given. And at the same time, the little bit of inclination of vocational education which was given to him in the previous preparatory stage now is complete. And at this particular stage of 6, 7, and 8, it's a 100% intermixing and interrelation between the general and the vocational education right from the school education. It is this particular period also which we recommend that the higher educational institutes, as part of their community outreach or as part of their social contribution to the society, should be outreaching and be adopting certain tier 2, tier 3 institutes, should be adopting schools for the purposes of visits or cross visits or for motivation to students and basically giving them a futuristic approach in their upbringing. This is the connect which we have recommended at this particular stage age group of the students so as to align them in a very correct manner to the subjects which they wish to take in the future, that is their parallel growth which they keep taking on. Unlike the present system of education where a student takes on a particular career path under a lot of pressure or from compulsions. Moving ahead from here, now we come to the last stage of school education, which is the last four, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. And ladies and gentlemen, this happens to be the most important aspect of school education, and this is called a secondary stage. It is very pertinent to mention here that AICT has already speaking made out a mandate that maths and physics is not mandatory for the purpose of taking on engineering education. Now, this is a very, very relevant and an apt subject and very nicely spoken with a single contention and a single idea that there are various engineering disciplines such as agriculture engineering, biotechnical engineering, and textile engineering, wherein that much importance of maths and physics is not relevant right from right from the beginning. So why push the students into learning maths and physics and then come into the engineering in these disciplines? However, should there be a necessity of imparting maths and physics at a later point of time, quite obviously you can incorporate in the form of giving them certain bridge courses. This is going to be a huge contributory factor as far as the overall gross enrollment ratio towards improving in higher technical education is concerned. This also brings me to another very important aspect, and that is this offering of various bracket of subjects and then student being given an option or a pick and choose liberty to pick and choose 3-4 subjects as per his choice, as far his framing up of education is concerned, is called as multidisciplinary concept in academics. Taking this forward to a higher education, what is multidisciplinary in our context of a higher technical education? And at the same time, what is the relevance and meaning of this when we talk of a multidisciplinary institute? There are two very important parameters. If we talk of multidisciplinary in education, in academics, multidisciplinary education and academics implies a student to be continue to be given a pick and choose option to framing his own course and degree and his certificate or his diploma with no fixed mandate. And we at AICT have proposed a ratio of 60, 20, 20, with 60 being the core subjects, that is the principal subjects, 20 being the core electives, and last 20 being the open electives. Primacy and importance is still given to the core which you have chosen to take on a graduation by having 60 and 20 given into your core subjects. However, the last 20 bracket of open electives, why this open electives have been given? The open electives have purely been given because as part of chapter 20 of the National Education Policy, which talks about professional education, in professional education, it has been mandated or given a guidelines that the future graduate who is going to come out of the higher institutes, not only technical but across the wide sector of educational institutes, he to be a wholesome individual who must have graduated in his respective discipline with a knowledge and inclination of agriculture, health, and legal. if agriculture, health and legal is now supposed to be introduced into your curriculum and into your syllabus for the purposes of student taking that course, we can decide and come forward with the credit-based courses, and credit-based courses then can be offered to the students from these disciplines. And the way of offering can be putting it in the basket of open electives, wherein it can be made mandatory for to the students to take it, besides many more other courses which can be put in this particular basket. We propose, and it can be a list is endless, we propose that there should be Indian knowledge system, there should be universal human values, Indian yoga, Indian dance, Indian music, Indian constitution, environment, you name a thing, and you can keep putting it in the open electives as a credit-based course for a student to frame in which particular field or sector he wishes to enhance his knowledge with a single purpose, so as to make him a wholesome individual, thereby enabling him to have a contribution towards the overall nation building. This is called as a multidisciplinary concept as far as higher technical education and academics is concerned. This is exactly the way we have proposed, and it is moving in that direction. Multidisciplinary institutes takes me to another angle on the same topic. Now, why did we go for this policy? The single reason of coming for this particular policy, and one of the biggest highlights or the drawbacks which were highlighted prior to the commencement of the directives and the policy, was basically a fragmented education system where there in multiple number of educational institutes which are existing, co-located side by side, offering the single discipline, single education system, engineering, management, pharmacy, all having an independence and doing in within the same geographical limits of a city or a district, with no absolutely intermixing, no mixing within departments, outside departments, within institute, outside departments, absolutely kind of in lack of ignorance of each other's existence. This has been highlighted as the biggest drawback, and to overcome this, it has been given in black and white in writing that no single silos, vertical institutes then would be existing, and the future institutes which would be existing will only be multidisciplinary higher educational institutes. This is the guideline. Now, if everybody has to become a multidisciplinary higher education institute, there's a very simple thing which we have also carried out an amendment in our approval handbook and guidelines, wherein we have recommended and suggested that a particular institute under the same trust or under the same company within, in addition against the existing guidelines, so within 2 kilometer radius to be merged. We have exceeded that 2 kilometer radius, and we have set it within the geographical limits of the city to be merged towards making it a multidisciplinary. Number two methods of making it a multidisciplinary is sharing of the resources, infrastructure, laboratory, your faculties, your literature. Number three, proposals. These are all proposals which can be done for the purposes of making it is extensive utility of the infrastructure towards, in the first half, use it for engineering. In the second half, you can use it the same infrastructure lab or multiple use by diploma. That is, these are the various proposals. And at the same time, when a multidisciplinary higher education institutes are being proposed, that they are the ones who would be surviving and they are the ones who would be then coming up. It has also been proposed that existing multidisciplinary institutes to be identified, they to be made as role models, and then these to be given a mandate and tasking of taking on various other institutes in their within the proximity towards promoting the multidisciplinary. And at the same time, when a multidisciplinary is promoted, there is a governance system also which has been recommended. And the governance system, and this has been recommended towards implementation by AICT, wherein we propose a university model of a multidisciplinary institute, because the national education policy talks of the word MERU. Multidisciplinary education research universities, they are going to be one, primacy with a focus on research. Number two happens to be university, which we're focusing on teaching. And number three, they are going to be autonomous undergraduate degree granting universities. If this has to be coming in, then the proposed governance model happens to be with a board of governors, academic council, the management, and then various departments led by various deans for the purposes of continuing the mandate which they have been given. One of the biggest mandates, or one of the biggest points which is supposed to be coming out from these multidisciplinary higher education institutes, happens to be that the academic councils and the board of governors needs to be coming out with a framework and a guidelines or the regulations for the purposes of credit sharing and credit acceptance. Mind you, ladies and gentlemen, I told you in my talk when I was beginning, the credit word is an extremely important word. Each and every multidisciplinary educational institute, what the National Education Policy so desires, that by 2035, every district of India would be having one multidisciplinary educational institute with minimum 3,000 students enrolled into that. If that has to come in and we have to exercise the option of multiple entry and multiple exit. This multiple entry and multiple exit is a directive which is coming in NEP 2020. Now, what is multiple entry and multiple exit? It's very easily understood that a student, for whatever reason, could not continue with higher education because of financial, administrative, or any reasons. Earlier time, he had to start with his education and then break it in between and then go back, and then he could not pursue, or he had to start from beginning. Presently, the system has been amended to read in such a manner that the student can always take a break from his education system and come back to pursue his education from the place that he left his education, as his credits earned will be retained. It would be retained, and he can always come back and start education from that point of time. It's not necessary for him to come back into the same institute. He can go to any institute anywhere in the country. That is what is the understandable or implementable point of NEP. But having said the implementable point of NEP, how does this credit concept also has to be practiced on ground? NEP also comes out with saying establishment of ABC, Academic Bank of Credit. Already we in the country have an NAD, National Academic Depository, but only thing is that they are the final graduate degrees or the big certificates or the diplomas are being uploaded for the purposes of verification or getting it back to it as and when required. That is under proposal, or there's a parallel body also being set up for the purpose of the studying the establishment of ABC. What AICT has recommended? AICT has recommended that for the purposes of employment, a certificate not to be generated after first year of exit in case somebody wants to exercise this option. However, his credits earned will be retained, primarily with a single reason that in first year the syllabus is common. Having said this, at the same time, AICT is also in the process of revising the technical education curriculum with a single mandate that certain value-based courses or skill-based courses are being introduced or in the process of being introduced so as to make a student who wants to exercise multiple exit option in such a position that whenever he exercises, he can gainfully utilize his credits which he has earned towards employability and nation building, as the case may be. Ladies and gentlemen, this multiple entry and multiple exit option is another very, very important contributory point to the overall gross enrollment ratio. When a multidisciplinary higher education institute is to be framed, that is what is the future as what is to be coming up. These, as per the mandate and guidelines for the National Education Policy, has also been told that they need to be given graded autonomy. That is the future of giving great autonomy to an institute for this purpose of the functioning. However, having said the word autonomy in our education system falls in three basic parameters. One happens to be administration, second finance, and third academics. Administration and finance, well known to everybody. There is no major aspect to be spoken on administration and finance, but speaking about academics, let's talk about academics. Autonomy in academics means with the freedom to design own curriculum, syllabus, content, freedom to design a degree, diploma, certificate, freedom to offer them, freedom to give credits, and freedom to accept or reject credits of the neighboring institutes, because today they are not in isolation. They are going to be intertwined and mixed with each other for the purposes of multiple entry and exit option to be exercised by the students. That is the reason that I told in the beginning that these multidisciplinary higher educational institutes, their academic council or their board of governors needs to be sitting down as and when they are being recognized as multidisciplinary higher education bodies for the purposes of enabling the provisions which have been given in the multiple entry and multiple exit options. And when all this is happening, all this is going to be in a purposeful manner, which would be in a platform. They are going to be connected towards a platform, and like I said, ABC, when they are going to be established, this credit sharing has to be done. The multidisciplinary institutes have to be registering there. When everything is being done for the purposes of utilizing the e-content and e-platform and online, this takes us to another very important activity which need not be highlighted, but if I will just give a reference, of the year which has gone by and even the times in which we are studying now. Online education, each one of us are seeing that it was the only means of education which we could give to our students. In fact, to various faculty programs, in fact, to the one in which we are connected today. If online education has taken us through to the year plus now, a national education policy, which was taken out in the month of July, August last year, has also given an emphasis of online education. UGC and AICT guidelines for the current year are very clear that 40% of credits will be retained or taken by the students for the purposes of degree in an online mode. If these are the current provisions, and just about a week or 10 days back, you would have seen the draft proposal which has come out that even the times to come, education to have 40% of online oblique blended form of teaching and learning to be included for the purposes of lifelong teaching and learning. It's not going to be only for the current year. So in case if online education is there to stay, AICT has already amended their provisions and guidelines. We have also carried out a change to the approval handbook, and wherein we are allowing online education to be there in certain subjects to start with, that is travel, tourism, logistics, management, and even certain engineering subjects where hands-on experience is not required, such as data sciences and artificial intelligence. Provided certain set guidelines have been given, that they need to be met by the respective institutes who wish to carry out online education for the purposes in these subjects. ODL also has been permitted by AICT in the same manner, in the same context, and in the same disciplines and streams which we have just mentioned about. Ladies and gentlemen, again, if I may use the word, promoting online, promoting ODL again would be having a very large contributory factor to the overall cross-enrollment ratio, giving an opportunity to our students who cannot physically come to an institute for the purposes of gaining education. This in continuity takes me to a very important aspect of an online education. I would in my sequentially, if I would have gone, because my connect to the faculty should always come at the last, highlighting the importance of a faculty. But because I spoke about online as of now, I would also like to reiterate that one of the very important chapters of the national education policy happens to be integration of technology. Integration of technology implies that the technology which is available around us is, English word is there for this, this is called as a disruptive technology. The disruptive technology implies that the technology is moving at a very fast pace, and what is relevant today is going to become obsolete tomorrow. So if that is the way that the technology is moving, it is an extremely important aspect for each and every faculty member who have chosen this particular profession as a career to understand the dynamics of the technology around you, identify the e-contents, e-literature, identify e-platforms, e-tools, various platforms which are available on the internet, and utilize them to the fullest towards imparting teaching and learning. That is going to be the future. No individual teacher now can survive primarily by saying that I will be having a classroom face-to-face teaching modality. With a single reason, please connect my previous conversation just about a minute back when I said current year 40% is online, and the times to come also this much percentage has been proposed. It is a draft under circulation for comments which has gone to all faculty and students alike. Suffice to say that online education is going to stay. And if that is going to stay, that each one of us who is into teaching and learning should mandatorily be aligned to the requirements. And towards this, the national education policy has directed an establishment of a forum called as NETF, National Education Technology Forum. Their mandate happens to be the same: identification of e-platforms, e-tools, e-contents, anything which can be utilized directly or with improvements or with modifications into our teaching and learning. And if that has to be utilized, it is a single purpose, that it's for the purposes of capacity building of the various institutes to get together, share, come on a common platform, and keep giving them continuous and periodic advice. But finally, the advice has to be acted upon, and the only set of people who are going to be acting upon these platforms happen to be the faculty members, towards ensuring that you are the one who is finally involved in a connect with the students. The national education policy, ladies and gentlemen, also talks about a very, very important mandate, and that mandate happens to be that by the year 2035, that is the end product of the national education policy, that by 2035, our country should be reaching at the global hub of education, that we should be the number one in the education. How can you reach number one in education? You can reach the number one in education by many multiple means. Some of them I have discussed as I went along. And some of them which come straight to the mind is, if you have to go international, then you need to be first and foremost identifying the reasons for which your own students, after doing the school education, go to abroad for higher education. Stop this outflux of our students first by finding or a course correction from within ourselves. I think each one of you know the pros and cons as to why it is happening, but ours is not to get into that. Ours is to understand as to how we can make our students be retained in our country and how we can do it. Let's talk about academics. We can straight away make it an eco-friendly, multidisciplinary higher education institutes in the time to come. Let's encompass each of the discipline. Let's have a collaborative concept. Let's give him an opportunity to design his or her own syllabus or the degree the way he wants to be moving ahead. Give him the freedom to go ahead in his study and pursue his education. And the most important for retaining him or making sure that he continues in India happens to be that initial, again, I mentioned about open electives, where in addition to agriculture, health and legal, I did mention about many more other subjects. There was a purpose why those subjects by name were mentioned. I mentioned about universal human values, Indian knowledge system, Indian music, Indian yoga, Indian dance. All this was with a purpose, and the purpose was when you bring about an Indianness into your education system, when you bring about the existing ethos, morality, culture, which we share, the tradition which we have in our Indianness system, and you bring it into your education, not only you're going to be stopping the outflux of your students going abroad, it is a well-proven fact that internationally the students are attracted to India primarily because of our rich culture and rich heritage. So if you bring it into your education, we are surely going to see a massive increase in international students coming to our future multidisciplinary higher education institutes. And both of this combined can also be a contributory factor towards the gross enrollment ratio. Every connectivity point has to be driven back home in such a manner that they come forward for a gross for improvement, and they are interlinked. Each point which was spoken or has been said is interlinked with each other. Now, in case if suppose education has to be seen in a holistic manner, then the education comprises of three major pivots. The first pivot happens to be the student, second the faculty, and third the institution. All three have to be taken in one go, and together we are supposed to be moving towards achieving the aim for which we are all set together to achieve. If this particular aim has to be achieved and a purpose of implementation of this is hinted and aimed for the student community, and in case if it's the students who are supposed to be graduating and then becoming the future of our country tomorrow, thereby getting an opportunity to contribute to the overall nation building, then in that eventuality, if students have to be taken as the focal point, then the students have a own inclusive chapter wherein it has been mentioned that the education which will then be provided will be a wholesome inclusive education. Now, what's an inclusive education? How do we define an inclusive education? An inclusive education is nothing but comprising of many, many subparts. One can be access, equality, equity, autonomy, accountability, affordability, and quality. I've said seven words. Each of them contributes towards the inclusive education. If I may talk about what is access, access is nothing but giving an opportunity to students to each and every item, thing, internet, facility, infrastructure, bandwidth, wherein he can then jump towards education. That's access. Equality is an extension of the Right to Education Act 2009, which said that irrespective of age, gender, caste, creed, religion, and financial status of the family, there will be no difference between any students and all students will be treated alike. That is equality. Equity happens to be no two students or no two human beings are born alike. Each one of us have our own individual characters and each one of us have our own pluses and minuses. It is for the teachers to identify the plus point and the minus point, or the positive and the weak points of a particular student, and then go about in teaching him in such a manner that you address the weak points of the students, thereby making him grow in a very, very correct manner. That is what is called as equity. Autonomy, I did mention when we spoke about the institutes. I said that in due course of time, all multidisciplinary higher education institutes are to be moved towards graded autonomy. And I said, and I would like to say it as of now, that whenever we speak of the word autonomy, the word accountability comes simultaneously. Autonomy cannot be given in isolation. With autonomy comes in accountability. What is accountability? Let us first talk of accountability of an institute. What's an accountability of an institute? Accountability of an institute is to ensure that the aim, mission, and vision for which you have been established is justified and is true to the complete spirits of the NEP 2020 in enabling the students to continue and foster their education in such a manner that they overall contribute to the country. And for this, in the same line, the National Education Policy is also mentioned as part of the regulation, the regulatory system, that the regulation which would be then be carried out will be light but tight. What are the provisions of light but tight? AICT has already come out with a mandatory application, which is called as DOST, which we call it as DOSTAP, for the purposes of granting approval, whether EOA or LOA every year. And this is all being carried out in an online manner, absolute transparent procedure with a provision for a voluntary disclosure by each and every respective institutes on the numerous set of questions which have been asked as part of the approval process. Now, this is called as the light aspect of the light but tight regulation. What is the tight regulation? The tight part of the regulation happens to be in case if some voluntary disclosure provided by an institute is found to be incorrect at a later point of time, a very severe penalty would be imposed in that particular institute. So that goes as far as the accountability aspect, but of an institute is concerned. When we talk of accountability, we should also talk of the accountability of a teacher. And accountability of the teacher is also existing, and that needs to be built in towards the overall path of the growth of the education. How do we build in accountability of a teacher? Already a 360 degree application has been circulated. 360 degree portal and app both are available for an all-round overall feedback of a particular teacher. It is also mandatory as far as 2019 AICT Gazette Regulation of 1 March 2019, which says that for promotion, 360 degree feedback is a mandatory subject. There is certain parameters also which has been given that each and every institute to follow a 360 degree guidelines based on those specific parameters. This is the time in case if people have not aligned, AICT has already taken out an application or a portal. Each and every institute to please register on that portal. You need not devise your own portal, but should you have your own existing portal, please visit the Gazette notification and make sure that your 360 degree feedback is as per the Gazette. That is the accountability. And then the next subject which I mentioned was about affordability. Affordability to a particular, when we talk of affordability, affordability aligns that you have to make education that much more affordable or approachable to a student. Affordability can be done by means of introducing scholarship, by means of reservation, by means of giving additional seats, or for that matter, we can also think about and talk about reduction in the fees. And why not, when an online education is the system and online education is going to be there, but there is a thought process that in case if a student has to spend about 40% of his time, at least in current reality, at home and not be in the hostel or a school or a college premises, why can't the fee structure be reduced? However, if the fee structure has to be reduced, the institute's consideration point also needs to be taken. And then when you take that consideration point, as part of multidisciplinary, I did speak in the beginning, sharing of resources, staggered timings. The same complex or a location can be utilized as an engineering, and subsequently in the evening, you can use it for the purposes of diploma. That these are the ways and means which needs to be built in for the purposes of moving forward towards an inclusive education. And after affordability, I use the word quality as far as the inclusive education is concerned. Ladies and gentlemen, we always talk of quality, but everybody, when every time we speak about quality, the very important aspect is what is quality? And when do you say that the quality has been achieved? There has to be something wherein you say, yes, I have achieved quality. But who defines quality and what is quality? Well, as far as our education system is concerned, quality is nothing but a certain standard benchmarks and parameters which have been laid down for each and every activity, for each and every discipline, defined by accreditation process. And once we achieve that, we say very proudly that we have achieved that initial benchmark and parameters, I have attained that quality, and hence now my mandate is to maintain or keep improving on that set quality parameters which I have achieved. This is also one of the very important aspects of the National Education Policy, which says that the coming multidisciplinary autonomous higher education institutes, now I've added the word autonomous, so multidisciplinary autonomous higher educational institutes will be fully accredited. This has also been given as your a statement in the National Education Policy. And ladies and gentlemen, I did give out the overall aim and mission of the NEP, that India needs to be moving it in such a direction that by 2030-35, in fact it's 35, that we should be seen as a center of the global education. And why 35? We feel should we be moving collectively, should the regulators, the bodies, the accrediting bodies, the various professional bodies, the institutes, the faculty move together? Why 35? We can achieve this by 2030. And if I may say, the onus for all this activity lies on the faculty, whether you are a serving, retired, academia, industrialist. It is the onus for moving forward is on these various aspects. Your Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, is already there in many forums and many activities towards committees for moving forward, giving their respective directions or recommendation as to how we should be moving. So the onus, I keep repeating, lies with the faculty. And when onus lies with the faculty, this has also been identified in the National Education Policy, and it has been mentioned that the right candidate for this profession be chosen at a very early age. So the teachers have been given a very big importance. And it has also been mentioned that a faster growth and promotion for teachers be ensured or introduced, subject to certain qualifying parameters, such as bright sparks who are moving fast in their life to be identified for the purposes of administration, for the purposes of management, for the purposes of leading the future multidisciplinary educational institutes. These are all being mentioned. How to implement that, various guidelines and provisions are coming into forum. There are many methods and schemes which have been introduced to identify, and we are in the process of also aligning it. And towards the wholesome teacher education, again, your Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, is part of a committee of national level committee of National Institute for Technical Teachers Training, NITTT. Now, that's a very important aspect towards giving teachers on a pedagogical training. We are today in the process of coming forward with the higher modules also. And at the same time, AICT has got many leadership programs. One of them happens to be UKRI program, which is done with the government of UK in connection with, wherein any senior professor or an associate professor who wishes or he feels that he or she is competent and capable and wants to come into leadership or administration or management should attend these AICT UKRI courses. It's offered partially in UK and partially in India. That is when the situation was normal. So many mandate, many schemes are provisioned towards enabling that the faculty are supposed to or continue to remain the focal point. And what is it looking like at the national level? How is it going to come out at the national level? The government is setting up the body called as HECI, which is called as HECI, Higher Education Commission of India, which is going to be having four verticals under them. The complete education now will be handled and mandated by the Higher Education Commission of India, HECI, except medical and legal. Each and every aspect of education now will be handled under this umbrella and the bracket. And there are four verticals which are coming into them. One of the verticals happen to be NHERC, National Higher Education Regulatory Council, which will be carrying out the regulation aspect of each and every discipline against the various bodies which were earlier carrying out. Number two will be HEGC, Higher Education Grants Council. There will be a common body henceforth carrying out or dispersing of the grants for the purposes of maintaining uniformity, and it is here only worthwhile to mention that the NEP also mentions establishment of an independent body called as NRF, National Research Foundation, which would be driving the agenda of research. And what is also pertinent to mention is that it we have recommended, and it has been found mentioned, that there will be no difference between government and private organization or institute for the purposes of research. Research perforce will lead into a useful product. There will be, because it has been observed that overall knowledge on IPR and patenting is little less. That is exactly what initial legal aspects I did mention, that legal subjects now will be taught. So NRF also is mandating to teach about legal aspects on IPR and patenting. We perforce say that undergraduate bachelor's will be of 4 years and master's will be of 2 years. Mandate of NRF has already come out. In case if you would have heard the finance minister speaking about two and a half, three months back about this year's budget, already the budget for NRF has been announced. So we are moving in that direction as far as the implementation is concerned. And the last of the four verticals or the body which is there will be called as the GEC, which is nothing but the General Education Council, wherein many existing councils, the Veterinary Council of India, Indian Council of Agriculture and Research, Architecture Council of India, these would be forming part as professional standard setting bodies to continuously keep monitoring the various developments happening in their respective fields and proposing amendments or alignments to the curriculum as per the industrial needs or as per the international standards as we move along. Suffice to say that the NEP is being taken and is being promoted in a very serious manner. A day doesn't go at AICT or in the ministry when we don't discuss on NEP and their implementable points. And again, I would like to repeat the last thing that collectively moving forward, we will surely be achieving what we have gone about to achieve. It was a pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, talking to you. Thank you, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, for being there throughout my talk. It's a great honor, sir, to have an eminent personality like you be listening to me, and Kare, sir, for giving me an opportunity to speak as part of this particular faculty development program training activity. Matharu, sir, it's a pleasure speaking when you're also taking the opportunity to listening. And Partha, sir, thank you for your introduction and giving me a go-ahead for speaks. I hope I've been able to give you a small insight into the NEP and its provisions, and this acts as a catalyst and many more people going to read what's the NEP all about. Thank you, sir, and warm regards to everybody.
Thank you, Venkat Saab. It was very nice presentation, and really, we are very thankful on behalf of Technical University that you have took out time out of your busy schedule. And really, we have learned a lot about the national education policy. So now I request to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to say a few words upon this particular presentation.
Right. First of all, I would like to pay sincere thanks from the university and all the participants, because this is the future which we have to go through. National education policy, how to implement it, and it presents throughout the country, there are certain confusions, because we do have all the structure of education policies or acts of university which derives all this education. It's somewhat rigid in its framework, where it is very ancient and classical way of imparting the teachers, the teaching and learning. Now this is a new concept which is somewhat having Western flexibility in it, that multiple input, multiple entry, multiple exit, any institution, any course, any subject, whatever the language you wish to have it, it is there. Like that, multiple flexibility is there at every point. So a contradictory and contrast is there with the experience and faith of our Indian community that we do want to go for certain rigid type of system where yardstick of qualification are fixed, and this is a fusion is needed and serious understanding is to be needed, and not only understanding of the people who are there responsible for implementation, But rather than the people, by and large, those faculties of our country, they will have to have comprehension of it. Of course, many resistance is coming out of your heart that this is not useful, this may be failure. We do have this type of system and we do have experience of it. It is working well. What is the need for replacing it? Many questions are coming and many resistance are coming. That's why it is an important issue. That's why I also wish to go for personally attending it so that the people along with me will be having a seriousness about the future, how we have to do it. Secondly, whenever we come across certain forum where we come to know different visions, mandate and mission of our national education policy, then all of us mentally bend towards the incorporation and imbibe of all these policies within our rigid framework of university, which is driven by eight ordinance and statute, how we have to incorporate it. That is the biggest question which I always think about since from morning to the night, how it can be overall changed. It is the biggest challenge for us, and that is how I am always interested and wish to see that our faculties should be also coming across certain imagination and contrasting situation, how we can incorporate it. That's why a special committee we had created at our university, who will be bridging up this one, looking upon the existing eight ordinance and statute. They will be looking upon the salient feature of NEP and how it can be transitionally incorporated over here. And after incorporation and before the incorporation, there is a great challenge with the university that we have to deal with certain group of people, group of students, with the older one that will need a different management, as well as we have to prepare for a new and open and flexible system to be incorporated. Fusion of these two systems, how we will be handling, that is also a big question before the university. And of course, there is no ambiguity, there is no doubt that how the indigenousness and all our ancient knowledge, culture and belief, ethics, values, all this in which we Indian traditionally, we are very much rich. How this can be incorporated so that it can be flourishing out of our country, and how we can come again, just like Takshashila and your Nalanda Vishwavidyalaya days, where the education was imported and the solution was brought in the form of research to the problems of the society, whether it is political, whether it is economical, whether it is administrative, whether it is scientific, whatever the problem was there, it was being built by those Nalanda Vishwavidyalaya and etc. That's why these universities were getting global fame in those days, where traveling and everything was too difficult and risky too. In those ancient days, the glory of knowledge, rich tradition and culture of Indian ethics and values was proliferated over all over the world. The same situation, we have to bring it, we have to try to bring it back, that glory, to the Indian education system. That is the basic of all our national education policy. And in this policy, for implementation, for achieving that particular goal, we see that all the faculties are the warrior, frontline warrior. We have to exert a lot out of our own, and before exerting ourselves, putting all across hard work, we should be mentally convinced that this is correct, this is the need of time, all the flexibilities to be incorporated in the system, in the mind, in the psychological. Then only we can definitely propagate in that direction, and then only we can bring it back in the system. And once it is the initial inertia of our faculty, it will be broken within 1 or 2 years. then I feel and I am confident after 2 years when all the mindset of faculty members of all over the country will be adopting and doing the excellence in the system, they will come out like anything. And by the end of 2035, I think we will be definitely at certain marking position to become the global leader in the education. That is how my vision feeling is there. And that's why I do not want to miss any opportunity, any talk which is being done on the national education policy. And being at the central position, Colonel B. Venkat is there, and he is at the central position. He is having interaction with many ministries and all those things on behalf of AICT. So that is how he has shared it, and definitely all of us have been benefited with it, and certain ideas and systematic inclusion of all these things will be paved away by this particular talk. So that is how I feel about it, and that is how I was personally interested about to go for attending this one. Once again, I would like to express on behalf of all the participants under this forum, FDP, express my sincere thanks to Colonel B. Venkat, and hopefully all of us together will be making a joint force and will be able to implement it in the right spirit, and will be able to achieve the right goal which has been dreamed out of MEP. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. An absolute honor, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Actually, our Vice Chancellor, sir, has done 4 reform in this technical university under this national education policy. I would like to inform you, Colonel. First, sir has constituted expert committee formation for technical book writing. 3 names from Chhattisgarh state has been forwarded to AICT for engineering branches as well as physics, chemistry, math. Already sent this consent for 23 books translation into Hindi regional language, and other constitution committee has been formulated by our honorable VC sir for question bank translation, in which we have already translated 23,000 questions in regional language, in which 13 subjects are included. How to inform you, sir, that in which this technical university and this Swami Vivekananda and Rajiv Gandhi University is also included. The faculty development programs, and last one that we have already, sir has given a study instruction to me that we have organized to make this non-teaching development training programs in administration people and finance people as well as you can say sports and staff officers will be joined, and it will be total offline programs. So we are planning that we will start soon in the month of July. Thank you very much, sir, Colonel Sahab, for your nice words. And
I would like to add, just in the recent days, 2 days back, we had our executive council meeting of the university, and there we had brought it one component of NEP, that making availability of all the ancient knowledge or new subjects or platform for new subjects to be infusion along with the old knowledge. So that is how we had come up with one ordinance which is making university enable to introduce any subject. This subject teaching will be available for everybody, not only to the students, not only to the teacher, but outside of the university. They will have to go through this course, those who will be registered, and they will be going through the process of examination. Then a special certificate of such subjects will be given. And first subject, which is out of my own inclination, I had introduced, it is techno-astronomy. So here technology to explore the astrological knowledge, ancient knowledge of Bhaskaracharya and others, will have to be infused, and they will be bringing out with astrological information. And my aim is to go for predicting, making a predictable or very efficient predictable tool for this seismic activity. So that is my first target out of introducing this particular subject, and I feel that by the end of next year, 2022 December, we will be in position to predict astrologically the very correct way to the this seismic events in the over the globe with date and time and epicenter. So that is how we had targeted infusion of old knowledge with the new technology and making it analysis. This particular subject I had not gone through anywhere, but it has been introduced by our own thought process, techno astrology. So that is how I just wanted to add how everybody can think, and I am inviting everybody, any faculty and every faculty, to give the suggestions like this, which practically can be imbibed in the present system and making a smooth transition from the rigid to the flexible one. That's right. Thank you very much for listening to this particular
introduction. Thank you sir. And over to BID organizing committee, Dr. Partha Rao, please continue.
Thank you very much, sir. Dear Padmavati, good evening to everyone. Padmavati, Oxford Computer Science and Engineering. I thank all the dignitaries present in this session, the Vice Chancellor, sir, and Venkat, sir, and Matharu, sir, R.N. Khare, sir, Mohan Gupta, sir, and Manisha Madhu, and all the dignitaries for being here. And I thank Venkat sir for the wonderful lecture he has given. We have got a clear idea, vision about the new educational policy. That means to make the education multidisciplinary and to make the education more Indian and to make the education synchronization with the disruptive technology, and it provides the synchronization. It provides multiple entry and multiple exit options to increase the gross enrollment ratio, to provide inclusive education with 7 attributes: access, equality, equity, autonomy, accountability, affordability, and quality. So I request all the faculty members to make their vision in alignment with HECR, so that we will reach the required objective, we achieve the required objective of the NEP. And thank you very much, sir. And I will give it to Partha Rao, sir, the coordinator of the program.
Thank you, ma'am.
I would like to take your leave because I had to attend another meeting. I had been constantly calling by that particular committee. So nice to see all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Best wishes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. And ma'am, and with your permission, I would like to take leave, sir.
Sir, yes, session khatam hi ho gaya hai. Last session tha, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I will request Arpana Rawal madam to please conclude the session. Ma'am, aapka muted hai.
I'm sorry. Closing the moments of fourth day of teachers training program, I on behalf of the whole BIT Durg fraternity extend our sincere gratitude to our session speaker, Colonel V. Venkat ji, who has really helped our nerves, mind, body and soul charged once again to set onto our own bootstraps in order to drive national education mission into more appropriate and more fruitful direction, sir. We also extend our sincere gratitude to Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Dr. M.K. Verma ji, who has spared his valuable moments to be with us. Also express gratitude to Professor Dr. S.P.S. Matharu ji, Professor NIT Raipur and observer to this program, to Dr. R.N. Khare ji, who is coordinator and university representative to teachers training program. Sir, your continued guidance since day one of the workshop has been keeping all of us in our elevated spirits. Our gratitude to guest of honor, Dr. Mohan Gupta, sir, Principal Bhilai Institute of Technology, Durg, respected Vice Principal, ma'am, of the Institute, Dr. Manisha Sharma ji, who both have been the two driving wheels of our ever-inspiring academic institution. Respected Dr. Arun Arora, sir, Director, IIT Durg, and our own very dynamic head of the department, Dr. M. V. Padmavati, who holds the prime responsibility to give this teacher's training program a very proper shape that is slowly moving on to its successful accomplishment on the fourth day of the program. So thank you once again. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, madam.
At the end, with your kind permission, Khareji, I have a summary report with me.
Okay. Please.
So on the fourth day of this teacher's training program, it was followed by the first session, forenoon session, led by Dr. Naresh Nagwani, sir, who initiated his addressing session by speaking on challenges, research, and real application domain scopes of clustering tasks that various ML communities are undertaking upon big data sets. He gave core insights on conventional approaches of clustering methods, density-based as well as grid-based. Expression representations were also given on how to measure distance-based metrics, and centroid parameters were also discussed. This was followed by demonstration of K-means clustering technique using sklearn library in form of Python codes, and that were easy for the audience to grasp, augmented with visualizations using dendrograms. At the end, the talk extended to the directions of performance evaluation of density-based and grid-based clustering techniques and their heavy dependency on feature extraction and input data pre-processing steps. This was followed by another forenoon session led by Dr. Ramalinga Cheruku. He began his addressing session by talking on the characteristics of dimensionality of the data sets, what are the disadvantages of using input data sets with very high dimensionality. He described about curse of dimensionality and how it affects the approach of selecting optimal set of attributes from a huge number of attributes given in the input data sets. Detailed description of how principal components can be calculated using vector operations and eigenvectors. He also vividly explained the computation using Python codes of computing eigenvectors and eigenvalues too. He had, and through an example, he explained how covariance matrix can also be computed. And afternoon session that was spoken by Colonel Venkat sir that we all have listened to with very eager. That's all for today's stuff. On to Dr. Khare sir.
Thank you, Rahul madam. Very nicely we have elaborated all the sessions. And that's I want actually that all the participants will get the benefit that what is the total major areas which is being covered by the experts. So really, I am very much thankful to BIT fraternity, especially Dr. Mohan Gupta ji, under whose leadership this program is going very wonderful. And all the, you can say, the participants from outside of the state will be definitely benefited. So thank you and have a nice day. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So tomorrow we will... tomorrow we will meet... Ma'am.
Yes, I just wanted to speak. Aap announcement kariye kal ke liye.
Ji. So tomorrow we'll meet at 10:30 a.m. Session number 13. Topic will be implementing supervised and unsupervised learning models using Python, except clustering. Speaker will be Dr. D. Lakshmi Padmaja from Anurag University, Hyderabad. So I will request all the candidates to be there 5 minutes before the session starts. So I will expect all the candidates to be present at 10:25 a.m. tomorrow. So thank you so much. Thank you, Khare sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Okay.